Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Stories Old Towns Tell, A Journey Through Cities at the Heart of Europe, by Marek Kohn. Narrated by Philip Battley. Introduction. Seven Symbolic Quarters. In the summer of 2017, I was invited to answer a questionnaire for Conversations with Europe, an online project created by Rebecca Buck, a pro-European blogger. One of the questions was, do you have a favourite place in Europe? If so, where is it, and why do you love it? I only had to think about that for a moment before I saw the answer in my mind's eye. The old town, I replied. It has a cobbled square, lots of Gothic overhangs, colourful heraldry featuring lions and boar's heads, narrow alleys, and not many right angles. It is in my imagination, as well as in the middle of many European cities, and I love it because it is the heart of my Europe. The idea for this book grew from that reply, but it had a lifetime behind it. When I was a young child, my first journey abroad took me from England to the heart of Europe. It crossed the two countries in which most of this book's action takes place, Germany and Poland, although in those days Germany itself was two countries. I was just old enough to be anxious about what would happen when we came to what was known as the Iron Curtain, and then to be a little disappointed that there was no great metal barrier across the railway lines running into East Berlin, just a guard in a sentry box at the side of the track. My anxieties were revived by the East German security officer who boarded the train, and I must have been relieved when he finally decided our papers were in order. Did he have a green uniform with a pistol in a holster? In my memory, it seems that he did. A column of tanks had clattered past, borne on the wagons of a goods train, as we waited on a platform in West Germany. Deep inside Poland, a station's pre-war German name was visible through a fading coat of paint on its signal box. These scenes of division and the shadows of war impressed Europe's history upon me. Time has passed. Europe's history has continued to unfold. While the images in my memory have become attenuated, their lessons have grown more profound. But they haven't diminished the appeal of the fantasy old town, definitely Middle European, as far as I'm concerned, in which history is charming and harmless. If anything, they have enhanced it. A comfortingly half-timbered and cobbled historic European quarter is the ideal spot for a brief escape from European history repeating itself. The journey's destination was the town of Toruń, where the Polish side of my family has had a home since before the war. Toruń's centre, proudly Gothic, was my first old town, and I still feel it to be part of my personal heritage, despite having previously failed to learn from its robust grid plan that some of the finest old towns in Europe were built on right angles. When I visited it in 2018 to register my details after recovering the Polish citizenship that had been revoked before my childhood visit, I took the opportunity to orient myself for an exploration of old towns. I found a gazetteer laid out along the central street, a series of tablets bearing the heraldic shields of cities to which Toruń had been linked by trade networks, reaching westwards as far as Leiden and Cologne during the Middle Ages and the Renaissance. With the Iron Curtain gone, and borders within the European Union mostly not even a formality, the city had celebrated its historic place in Europe by selecting symbols from its past that claimed a place for it in Europe's future. The tablets form an elegant display, and a neat illustration of how old towns are made to work. Another old town occupied a special place in the stories about Poland's history and character that I was told as a child. It was at the heart of the story of Warsaw's destruction by Nazi German occupiers and the Polish capital's post-war reconstruction, in which Poles cleared the rubble by hand and then painstakingly recreated the old town in its historic form. The lesson was that despite the extraordinary barbarities visited upon Poland by its enemies, the nation's spirit could not be broken. It was a lesson not just for Poles, but for the world at large, as President Biden affirmed when he spoke at Warsaw's Royal Castle, which forms an ensemble with the adjacent Old Town, a month after Russia launched its assault on Ukraine. We are gathered here at the royal castle in this city that holds a sacred place in the history not only of Europe, but humankind's unending search for freedom, he declared. As Joe Biden and his team appreciated, the castle was a setting of ideal symbolic aptness for the American president's history-defining message that democracy faced years and decades of struggle against the forces of autocracy. By using the royal castle as the stage for a rallying speech in response to Russia's invasion, Biden demonstrated that historic quarters are not just reserves for relics, but live sites with roles to play in current affairs and contemporary consciousness. A further demonstration followed in the summer when the wrecks of Russian armoured vehicles knocked out by Ukrainian forces were put on display in the square between the royal castle and the old town. The oxidized armor, symbolizing the possibility that Russia could be defeated, was thus posed against a background of buildings rebuilt after their destruction by the Nazi aggressors. Introducing the exhibit, the Polish Prime Minister's Chief of Staff declared that the square embodies the heroism of the Polish defenders during the Warsaw Uprising, while also standing as a witness to the devastation inflicted on the city by the occupiers. Today we are dealing with a similar situation in Ukraine, he observed. Russian barbarians are destroying villages and cities. The story of Warsaw's old town in 1944 was summoned up to help tell the story of Ukrainian cities in 2022. On another front, a few months before Russia's onslaught initiated a new phase of Europe's history, Poland's justice minister welcomed the European Union's Commissioner for Justice to Warsaw with a framed photo of the old town laid waste after the Nazi occupation. Having previously accused the European Union of waging hybrid war against Poland in a dispute about Polish government actions that the EU regarded as threats to the rule of law, the minister explained that his passive-aggressive gift symbolized Poland's sensitivities about the equal treatment of nations. It certainly illustrated the indestructible symbolic authority of the old town's ruins, the moral foundation of the reconstructed quarter. As a child of Polish heritage, I was awed and filled with pride by Poland's great national stories. As a person of both British and Polish heritage, I've gone through life with a constant background awareness that one story is never the whole story, a belief that is better to bring identities together than to keep them apart, and a sense that stories are enriched by informing each other. I found a text that spoke to those feelings in a third old town, that of Lublin in southeastern Poland, where one of the old gatehouse buildings has been turned into a centre devoted to the memory of the city's Jewish population, exterminated in the Holocaust. A panel on the wall addresses a frequently asked question. Jews who come here ask us, why do you do this? After all, you are not Jewish. You are Poles, and the Jewish town is not your history. Poles ask us, why do you do this? After all, you are Poles, and the Jewish town is not our history. Or maybe you are Jewish. We explain patiently that it is our common Polish-Jewish history. To remember the murdered Jews, you do not have to be Jewish. Like the mathematical models that scientists devise in order to clarify the complexities of life, this sequence demonstrates the power and the necessity of simplification. In most contexts, unqualified distinctions between Jews and Poles act to efface the possibility that people might be both Jewish and Polish. Here, the binary acts in the opposite direction. It serves to heighten the rhetorical contrast, and thereby to sharpen the argument that the two groups are more closely intertwined than is widely assumed. Those who read the Polish and Hebrew versions of the text will be aware of the fraught histories that lie behind it, but those who read the text in English may not appreciate the implications that underlie Polish questions about whether a person is Jewish or the undermining effects that they can have upon both public and personal conversation. As it happened, I encountered the question myself at the end of the tour in a gallery dedicated to righteous non-Jewish Poles who helped Jewish compatriots during the war. When I remarked that one of the Jews mentioned in a panel had the same name as me, the guide suggested that I might be a relative. I replied that from what I knew of my family tree, it was very unlikely. He gave me a sceptical look that made it plain he thought I was denying Jewish ancestry. I'm reluctant to answer the question because it is always loaded one way or another, and also because the full answer remains mysterious. But I'm happy to imagine that my surname marks a time when Jewish and Christian Poles could be relatively relaxed about interlinking their family histories through marriage. There is too much to say on these themes, and often the more that is said, the more difficult it becomes to resolve them. Sometimes divisive certainties are best countered not by nuance, but by simple and bold declaration of values. The assertion of a common Polish-Jewish history was like a revelation that I already knew, filling me with a sweet sense of recognition, gratitude, and relief combined. I still feel heartened when I look at the photo I took of the panel, and reassured that better histories are possible. A cobbled square in an old quarter of a European city, filled with people eating ice creams and chatting in their various languages, is a scene of triumph. Historic spaces in which people gather together freely and convivially, among strangers but at ease with them, represent how far the continent has succeeded in transcending its history. Turning the past into picturesque ambience, they convey a sense of safety and peace. Where the remnants of old defensive walls still stand, the obsolete masonry offers the reassuring suggestion that the age of conflicts was a long time ago. Old towns affirm that the European condition need not be one of eternal conflict between endlessly arising and realigning adversaries. They are beacons of the redemptive European project. The message is especially eloquent in cities that were devastated during the Second World War and then divided from each other for more than 40 years of Cold War by the Iron Curtain. In the heart of Europe, Germany and the lands to its east, the most catastrophic episodes in the old town's long histories took place within living memory during the Second World War. Firestorms, massacres, ethnic cleansing, genocide. Those were the foundations upon which historic quarters were rebuilt into urban Arcadias. When the Cold War and the 20th century were finally behind them, the region's old towns completed their transformation from places in which war seemed inescapable to ones in which it seemed unimaginable, at least until Russia brought the fear of imperial aggression back to Europe once again. The facades plastered over the fractures, though. Old towns make harmonious compositions out of history by omitting, erasing, or downplaying some of its storylines. Since the end of the Second World War, old towns have been painstakingly constructed to narrate their histories selectively, edited to highlight some strands while occluding others. To regard the work done on them as simply preservation, the respectful maintenance of a relic island while the rest of the city gets on with its dynamic urban life, is to miss the point of old towns. They are the central symbolic districts of cities, their role as fundamental as those of the central business districts or government quarters. Old towns are the foci of collective memory that make suggestions about collective character. They are nuclei of identity, representing nations and peoples, as well as the cities in which they are embedded. That is inevitably a work in progress, for identities are always changing and their supporting narratives need to be adjusted with them, either to acknowledge change or to pretend that it doesn't happen. Old towns are always under construction. They are refurbished, restored, reframed, and sometimes rebuilt altogether. Frankfurt am Main opened its new old town in 2018 against a backdrop of skyscrapers. It was the latest rethink for a German city still uncertain about what kind of relationship it should have with its past, more than 70 years after the end of the war. By that point, Europeans seem to have forgotten the lesson of the war, that they must build a new common history dating from 1945. Fewer and fewer of those who had learned it through personal experience were still alive, and as the last of those who had actually fought the war approached extinction, the mood changed. Perhaps it was not entirely coincidental that Europe and the wider world underwent a shift away from openness, amid loud demands to put nations first and to define them narrowly. Neighbours were to be begrudged and strangers to be regarded with suspicion. People wanted their borders back. 2 years after the opening of Frankfurt's new old town, they got them. Lines that had become visible only on maps became impassable barriers as European states sealed themselves off in response to the coronavirus pandemic. The eerie emptiness of public spaces provided a jarring illustration of why we should treasure the sight of people wandering through cobbled streets, eating ice creams, and mingling with each other freely. And 2 years after that, as coronavirus restrictions were beginning to be lifted, Russia's attack on Ukraine showed that European cities could still be devastated by bombardment. The onslaught was brutal proof that however far Europe has come since 1945, it has not come far enough. These developments have thrown the significance of old towns into relief. Zones that have been configured to promote singular historical narratives, rather than to interweave the plural histories that they could represent, form a constellation that documents the post-war history of European nationalism itself. If Europe is to hold together, instead of pulling itself apart, it has to find ways of reconciling its histories. With their densely packed payloads of symbols, its old towns are key sites, not just of its past, but also for its future. Their potential for telling inclusive stories has not yet been fully explored. As the American literary critic Van Wyck Brooks observed in 1918, the past is an inexhaustible storehouse of apt attitudes and adaptable ideals. It can furnish a selection of attitudes and ideals to match those favoured in any subsequent period, enabling the compilation of what Brooks called a usable past. Around the world, history is returning with a plethora of vengeances. People are turning to the past from different sides. Some want a reckoning with it, others want to live in it. For people of diverse backgrounds to live well together, they need to develop narratives that integrate their histories, or at least to create frameworks in which their different narratives can coexist. That is also the problem that old towns pose. The question of how to represent plural and sometimes conflicting histories within them has a significance far beyond those highly charged symbolic spaces. To explore it, we have to lift the cobbles and look at the layer of ash underneath. That stratum represents the devastation of cities by carpet bombing, urban battles, and, in the case of Warsaw, systematic demolition by enemy troops. Cities in the core of Europe restarted their histories in 1945 upon three founding conditions: the destruction of urban fabric, the genocide of Jewish populations, and the replacement of pre-war inhabitants by people drawn or driven from other places. Although these conditions did not have a uniform impact throughout the region, they defined its post-war landscape. Journeys to the heart of Europe were journeys to the scenes of the most dreadful events in the continent's history, some of them still unfolding. Because it was the zone of greatest devastation, and because new ideological orders were being imposed upon it, this was the region where the most radical questions about reconstruction were posed. That is the decisive reason why this book explores places within the sweep of continental heartland east of the Rhine. Middle Europe can serve as a label for the region, so as to avoid the connotations of Mitteleuropa, Viennese-flavoured nostalgia, bygone German political ambitions, and historians' arguments about where Central Europe is, but not across the entire map of the continent. The book spends much of its time in Polish cities, past and present. It was emotionally natural for me to use my personal heritage as a basis for examining a constellation of European heritage, and analytically logical. Middle Europe's eastern half offers many paths to understanding Europe as a whole, some of them clearer than the ones taken in regions to the west that are inclined to consider themselves more central and significant. In particular, the post-war role of nationalism can be followed more easily in the east than in Germany, where nationalist currents were stifled and confounded by the defeat of their Nazi variant. More fundamentally, awareness of the eastern half's history inculcates the awareness my first journey across Middle Europe helped to impress upon me, that peace cannot be taken for granted. The burned-out armour displayed against a backdrop of reconstructed old townhouses in Warsaw serves as a dramatically apt symbol for that lesson. I did not know that an aggressor would start a war in Europe before I completed this book. but I wrote it because I was alarmed by the growth of the tensions and divisions that find their most extreme form in war. The centrality of the lands east of Germany has now become more widely apparent. More of the book's time is spent in Warsaw's old town and its surrounding stories of the people and the political forces that shaped its reconstruction than in any of the other sites. The old town's wartime drama is uniquely compelling, a siege that became a crucial battle and ended in a tragic defeat, followed by massacres and the near-total destruction of the quarter. Its post-war story is also unique, for although it was not the only historic district in the region to be left almost completely in ruins, it was the only one to be entirely rebuilt in the image of its former self. The resurrection impressed foreign onlookers as a demonstration of national resolve, and presented a model for reconstruction that challenged internationally accepted views about the legitimacy of replicas. It became a landmark in post-war European debates about the preservation of heritage. France's Minister of Culture, the novelist André Malraux, invoked it when he spoke in support of a heritage law framed to protect districts as well as individual buildings. "Let's not allow the old streets of Avignon to be destroyed at a time when Poland has rebuilt the oldest square in Warsaw stone by stone," he urged. As a furiously modernizing Europe remade itself in concrete, raising tower blocks in place of houses and driving highways through city centres, Warsaw's old town offered the continent a lesson in values. Sometimes the past was so precious that it had to be recreated if it had ceased to exist. The story of the old town is the story of the people who tried to protect it in the war and rebuilt it afterwards. Right from the start of the occupation, people trained in disciplines surrounding heritage risked and sometimes lost their lives trying to save it. Architects, conservators, and art historians became soldiers of the underground state, with special responsibility for protecting the documentation that would be needed to repair the city's losses. They held soldiers' ranks, and some of them bore arms. After the war, they had to decide whether to work for the reconstruction under a regime that was locking up their former comrades and denouncing the state that they had served. They chose to rebuild for the sake of the nation, directed by authorities that saw heritage such as the old town as a vital resource in the struggle for Polish hearts and minds. Warsaw's old town is one of seven main sites in this book. They form a loose arc spanning Middle Europe, from Germany to Lithuania, and they offer answers to a complex of questions. How they fared before the war and what happened to them during it, how they were reconstructed afterwards and why, what they remembered and what they forgot, what stories they told and what stories they could tell. Warsaw. Chapter 1. Market to Monument. Warsaw's founding colonel has been old for a long time. The zone within the city's medieval walls first acquired the label in the 15th century, when a new town development began to arise next to it. At that stage, Warsaw was a provincial city of modest importance. Its status, relative to that of Krakow, where the Polish kings had their seat, can be measured by the area of its central market square. At 4 hectares, Krakow's king-size market square is 6 times larger. The balance of power began to shift towards Warsaw in the 16th century. In 1569, the Kingdom of Poland and the Grand Duchy of Lithuania were joined together by the Union of Lublin, named after the southern city in which it was signed. The agreement created a dual state known as the Republic, or Commonwealth as modern English language texts conventionally have it, which in those days did not mean a state without kings. It was a vast, sprawling entity with 2 capitals, Krakow and Vilnius, far apart from each other. Warsaw lies roughly midway between them, so the Union of Lublin agreed that it should be the site for the dual state's parliament. In 1596, King Zygmunt III Vasa decided to move his court there from Krakow. The castle that presided over the old town became the royal castle, and Warsaw became Poland's capital city. Within the walls, the old town began to acquire its definitive form, assisted by a fire that destroyed a large part of the quarter in 1607. Burned-out Gothic tenement houses were rebuilt in late Renaissance and early Baroque styles. The neighbourhood became a showcase for mercantile prosperity. Its heyday lasted into the 18th century, but its prestige diminished as the nobility moved out to the suburbs where there was room for them to build palaces. Meanwhile, the Polish-Lithuanian Republic grew increasingly weak and vulnerable to its neighbours, Russia, Prussia, and Austria, which divided it up in a series of partitions. By the end of the century, they had removed it from the map altogether, and Warsaw was no longer the capital of a sovereign nation. The old town lost its role as an annex to the centre of political power and went into decline. As the wealthy bourgeoisie moved out, the market square filled up with humble traders. The neighbourhood that had boasted Warsaw's wealthiest residents became home to many of the city's poorest inhabitants. At the beginning of the 20th century, a plan to put a market hall on the square was met with dismay in Warsaw's cultural circles. The old town was following a storyline similar to those that unfolded in historic quarters across Middle Europe, of deterioration in the 19th century and adoption by heritage protectors in the 20th. Its principal advocate was a national organisation rather than a group of local enthusiasts. In 1911, the Society for the Care of Monuments of the Past established its headquarters on the Market Square, taking over a tenement house named after the building's 17th century merchant owners, the Boryczka family. The move reasserted the central place of the old town in Poland's symbolic landscape. It was followed in short order by the clearance of the market from the Market Square, which received a makeover that the heritage activists considered more appropriate to its status, giving it a more monumental character. The statue that served as its centrepiece and represented Warsaw's heraldic emblem, a mermaid brandishing a sword, was raised up and placed on a pedestal. By turning the Boryczka house into a hub for gatherings and exhibitions, the society furthered its aim of strengthening the cultural communities that were striving to protect the nation's heritage under foreign rule. Members of the society supported the project with ventures into gentrification, buying old town tenement houses and doing them up. The new owners included several architects, a painter, and a poet, known by the nom de plume Orot, who wrote lyrical verse devoted to the old town. Visits to the Boryczka house and the surrounding quarter were not only fashionable, but also, according to the society's president, acts of opposition to the city's Russian overlords. In 1916, the four rows of tenement houses framing the market square were named after eminent civic Warsawians who had been active in the years before Poland's independence was extinguished. It was a notable early step in the process of converting the old town into an exhibition space for the teaching of history and the promotion of national consciousness. At the end of the First World War, Poland returned to the map as an independent state, following the collapse of three empires that had partitioned the Polish-Lithuanian Republic between them. The Second Republic resembled its predecessor in that it stretched a long way to the east and contained a variety of ethnic groups. Nearly 4 million Ukrainians found themselves within the borders of the new state, as did 2 million Jews, the second largest minority. In all, the minorities added up to more than 30% of the population. Warsaw was thus the capital of a nation whose form was consistent with the vision of its dominant political figure, Józef Piłsudski, who became the head of the restored Poland. Piłsudski believed that the new republic needed territories beyond its heartland, so that it would be big enough to hold its own as a regional power, and he was confident that it could incorporate ethnic minorities as citizens. He hankered after an even closer resemblance to the old Republic of Both Nations, but his proposals for a federation with Lithuania fell on stony ground. Instead, he had to satisfy himself with holding Vilnius, thereby creating a sacred cause for Lithuanian nationalists and setting the two countries at odds for the remainder of their spell of independence between the two wars. The dream of creating a new Polish-Lithuanian republic was not shared by Piłsudski's great rival, Roman Dmowski, the great theorist of Polish ethnic nationalism and the leader of the national democracy movement. Dmowski understood the nation as a single living organism, with a unique spirit formed from culture, history, language, tradition, and race. He maintained that minorities posed threats to the Polish nation simply by their presence, undermining Polish culture by exposing it to contact with their own. While he considered that Slavic minorities could be neutralized by assimilating them into the Polish majority, he denied that Jews could ever be Poles. In his view, Jewish culture was so strong and so alien that it posed a lethal threat to the Polish nation. Assimilation was even more threatening than the continued existence of separate Jewish communities because it brought toxically incompatible Jewish elements into Polish Christian society. Mingling with the majority of them would lead to our destruction, he warned. After the restoration of independence, Dmowski was faced not only with a country in which minorities comprised 3/10 of the population, but also a capital city in which 1/3 of the population was Jewish. Warsaw was the scene of intense cultural mingling, in which Jewish Poles made some of the period's richest contributions to Polish literature and arts. It was a metropolis in the international style, boasting a city centre bright with neon lights and nightclubs, and that was an affront to nationalists who dreamed of a great Poland from which foreign influences would be purged. Pilsudski kept the National Democrats and their ilk in check, but they lost no time in stepping up their anti-Semitic agitation after his death in 1935. As well as organising boycotts of Jewish businesses, an increasingly radical nationalist front campaigned to exclude Jews from higher education and the professions. It scored a stunning success within Warsaw's architectural milieu, tearing a hole in the city's cultural fabric. For its part, the old town continued on the path of cultural gentrification set by the Heritage Society before the First World War. Tenement houses on the market square accommodated a publishing society, 2 writers' associations, and the editorial offices of a historical journal. The priorities were those suggested by the pre-war redevelopment of the square, which had entailed the eviction of the market stall holders. Concern for the status and appearance of the quarter was not matched by concern for the needs of its residents, many of whom lived in mouldering and overcrowded squalor. In 1928, the houses on the market square were painted with polychrome decorations to celebrate the Second Republic's 10th anniversary. The facelift was not a triumph. Commentators criticised both the quality of the painting and the decision to lavish money on façades instead of repairing the decaying houses of the district and alleviating the living conditions of the people crammed into them. The parlous state of the quarter was highlighted by reports of the collapse of tenement houses, said to have been shaken apart by the increasing number of motor vehicles that rasped their way through the district. A number of buildings were demolished deliberately to expose a surviving stretch of the medieval defensive walls that had defined the area of the old town. Directed by Jan Zakwatowicz, an architect and conservation expert, the project was intended to expand the quarter's function as a museum of itself and to enhance it with a public amenity in the form of gardens between the double walls. Zakwatowicz also oversaw works for the conversion of the Boryczka House and 2 of its neighbours into a museum of old Warsaw, following the acquisition of the buildings by the city in the late 1930s. The museum was planned to open in the autumn of 1939, but by that time the forces of the Third Reich had invaded Poland, the Second Republic had fallen, and Warsaw was under German occupation. Chapter 2. Soldier Architects. When Maria Uber set out to meet her professors, she did not know whether her journey would end in a Warsaw apartment or a German labour camp. The train from Krakow left around midnight, but she had to get to the station several hours earlier, before the curfew, and then struggle to board amid the throng of people who pushed through the coach doors and clambered in through the windows. Many were traders, stuffing the carriages with huge bundles of goods, leaving little room even to breathe on the 8-hour overnight journey. All were vulnerable to roundups, in which passengers were ordered off the train and into trucks that took them away to forced labour in Nazi Germany. Maria made the trip to Warsaw about once a month, for 1.5 years. Her luck almost ran out on one of these occasions, when her train was emptied for a roundup, but her acting skills saved her. She went up to the SS officer in charge of the operation and told him, in German, that she absolutely had to be in Warsaw the next day in connection with matters very important to the Reich. The SS man let her get back on board, but nobody else. Maria continued her journey with just 3 other passengers for company, men who had managed to escape the sweep by hiding in the toilets. There could hardly have been a more dramatic contrast with the beginning of her studies. Maria had spent the last part of her first year as an architecture student in the picturesque southern Polish highlands, surveying traditional wooden buildings. That was in the summer of 1939, though, and the exercise was terminated prematurely. When Poland mobilized its armed forces in the final days of August, the students were hurriedly cleared out of their summer lodgings. On the 1st of September, the Nazi regime launched its invasion. On the 1st of October, its forces took control of Warsaw. The country was overrun from both sides, Germany taking the west and the Soviet Union the east, and wiped off the map. Maria had been enrolled in the country's leading architectural school, Warsaw Polytechnic's Faculty of Architecture. The German occupiers closed the Polytechnic, along with all the other higher education institutions in the territories under their control. Professor Oskar Sosnowski, the instigator of the students' fieldwork courses, was killed in the siege of the capital. He had moved himself and his family into the Faculty of Architecture building in order to safeguard its collections. A few days before the city's surrender, he was fatally wounded by a bomb that hit the courtyard. Sosnowski was the founder of the Institute of Polish Architecture, a historically oriented body within the faculty. The field surveys were a core element of the Institute's activities and formed an important part of the archives that he had died trying to protect. They had a dual purpose, being intended not only to train students in core skills, but also to produce an inventory of Poland's built heritage. After the city sustained damage to its royal castle and trauma to its fabric from the German assault, Sosnowski's documents took on a profound new significance as records of lost or threatened national heritage and blueprints for reconstruction. Sosnowski was succeeded by his colleague Jan Zakwatowicz, who risked his life to recover another archive of historic building documentation in the aftermath of Warsaw's fall. The records were stored in a basement of what had hitherto been the Ministry of Religious Affairs and Public Education, but was now the headquarters of the Nazi secret police, known as the Gestapo. An art historian who had been in charge of the state art collections heard that the occupiers were planning to throw the records out. Fortunately, the Gestapo had not yet dismissed all the building's Polish staff, one of whom opened a gate for Zakwatowicz, the art historian, and several helpers from the Faculty of Architecture to drive through in a truck. Even more fortunately, the Gestapo officers who saw them assumed that they were on authorized business. They made two trips, recovering 138 boxes of materials and transferring them to the architecture faculty building. The Gestapo subsequently used the basement to hold and interrogate prisoners. The architects used the documents to rebuild the capital. Warsaw's rebuilders also made use of fragments that Zakwatowicz had helped to recover from the damaged royal castle in the bitter winter after the conquest. Zakwatowicz had joined the army when the war broke out, and had been awarded the Military Cross of Valor 10 days before Poland capitulated. He was the model of the soldier-architect, a hybrid combatant variety on whom the nation's built heritage came to depend, both during the war and after it. Under the leadership of Professor Jan, Sosnowski's former colleagues and students continued the inventory work during the occupation, surveying buildings in Warsaw's Old Town and other districts of the city. It was a kind of unwritten testament, observed Maria Uber's fiancé, Kazimierz Maciej Piechotka, who had been a student and then a teacher in the Institute of Polish Architecture. He was also a soldier architect, active in the conspiracy, as the resistance against the occupiers was known. The lie that Uber told the SS officer contained a bold truth. By pursuing her studies, she was indeed engaged on a matter of great importance to the Reich. Nazi policy was resolved to destroy Poland's intellectual and cultural resources, as well as the structures of its state. The occupiers had made their intentions clear in the autumn of 1939 by arresting nearly 200 academics at the Jagiellonian University in Krakow and dispatching them to a concentration camp. Thousands of educated people perished in systematic campaigns of mass murder directed against the intelligentsia. The aim was to deprive the nation of its elites so that it would be incapable of reclaiming its place on the map. In response, Poland built a state that conducted resistance through education as well as espionage and ambushes. The Polytechnic architects and their students set up a secret faculty of architecture in which qualifications were awarded and plans for post-war reconstruction drawn up. Its dean, a civil engineer named Stefan Briwa, held classes and oversaw doctoral examinations in his apartment. Faculty members led a dual life, concealing their covert activities behind those that the occupiers still permitted, which included municipal work and interior design. They were able to return to their building in 1941, thanks to the German authorities' decision to install a technical school for construction skills in it. Although Nazi ideology held that Poles should be deprived of all but minimal education, the occupiers found that they needed local personnel with basic professional building qualifications in order to maintain the city they had battered and taken. With its railway links and munitions factories, Warsaw assumed major strategic importance after Germany attacked the Soviet Union. Many of the people involved with the wartime Faculty of Architecture served the military side of the secret state as well as the civil one. As the underground state was not in a position to pay its operatives proper salaries, they had to make ends meet as best they could. Kazimierz Piechotka had a job for a time as a salesman for a pharmacy glassware manufacturer, then meagre earnings from his work in the studio at the former Faculty of Architecture building, and occasional payments in kind, such as small quantities of flour or oil. He completed his studies during the occupation, rising early to make the most of the daylight for drawing. After working on his own projects, he went to the studio, where he spent the rest of the morning. His duties included the inventory of historic buildings, and he also worked as a draftsman on the reconstruction plans. Then, around midday, he would go to the post office, a rendezvous with a messenger who would pass on orders for the afternoon's secret work. The ability to execute plans and drawings was a skill that transferred readily to the forging of documents, a crucial requirement for the underground state's extensive network of intelligence operations, and architects formed a significant proportion of the forgery workshop's personnel. Agents always needed aliases, being vulnerable to checks and roundups at any moment. A courier travelling across Europe would need a sheaf of identity and travel documents, many of which were surreptitiously produced in the faculty building. The industrious Polish forgers not only kept up with their own intelligence services' demands for legalization, as the provision of fake credentials and passes was termed, but even supplied the French resistance with bogus papers too. Piechotka was part of a three-person cell headed by Piotr Biegański, who completed his doctorate in architecture while working in the forgery studio, a room in the Institute of Polish Architecture's premises. The third member was Zofia Hojnacka, who had gone to study architecture in the secret faculty after recovering from injuries she sustained while serving in the city's defense organization during the siege. Her speciality was writing German texts. Piechotka's was forging signatures. As was standard practice in the resistance conspiracy, they had nom de guerre. Piechotka was Jacek, Hojnacka was Agata, and Biegański was Paweł. They struggled to decide what to call their cell, but ended up naming it after the local patisserie, Gajewski, in which they were sitting at the time. The forgery operation came under the control of the intelligence section of the Armia Krajowa, or Home Army, the main Polish resistance force. It was organized by another alumnus of the Faculty of Architecture, whose return to his alma mater was even more dramatic and hazardous than Maria Huber's journeys from Krakow. Stanisław Jankowski came all the way from England, reaching Polish airspace in a bomber and landing by parachute. Jankowski had completed his studies and obtained a position as an assistant lecturer when the war broke out. Called up as a reservist, he was interned after his unit sought to shelter in Lithuania, but he managed to escape and make his way to France. The Germans followed him there, and he became one of the thousands of exiled Polish servicemen who crossed the Channel when the country fell. On the day that he reached England, the SS and German police massacred 358 Poles in a forest near Warsaw. The action was part of the Nazi project to extirpate Poland's intelligentsia and its cultural life. The victims included politicians, lawyers, doctors, teachers, writers, artists, and athletes. Among them were Jankowski's father and brother. The Polish forces regrouped in Britain, and the government in exile also sponsored civil elements of resistance. It helped to establish a Polish school of architecture at the University of Liverpool, where students learned the skills that would be needed for the reconstruction and drew pictures of how it might look. Stanisław Jankowski was ideally qualified for the school, but he had already been selected to take the Polish Armed Forces Military Administration Improvement course in London. This came as an unexpected and unwelcome surprise to him, since he had not previously known of the course, displayed any aptitude for administration, or harboured any desire to serve his nation in an administrative capacity. The course's curriculum turned out to be more exciting than its title, though. It featured lectures on ciphers, Morse code, poisons, lockpicking, and blowing up ships. Behind the cover name, it was the training programme for intelligence officers. They became known as the Cichociemni, from Cicho, silent, and Ciemni, dark. Their mission would be to return to their homeland and join the underground Armia Krajowa, or AK. They went by plane and landed by parachute, on the sixth attempt in Jankowski's case. His first three missions were cancelled before takeoff. The fourth succeeded in reaching Polish airspace, but was confounded by cloud that made accurate navigation impossible. They flew 3,000 kilometres and breathed Polish air, Jankowski observed, but the 300 metres of the parachute descent had proved beyond them. On the fifth flight, one of the Halifax bomber's four engines was knocked out by anti-aircraft fire near the Danish coast. The plane pressed on to the Baltic, but eventually had to turn back, weighed down by ice and buffeted by winds. The crew of the sixth flight evaded ground fire by crossing the sea at low level and Denmark at treetop height, then followed the pale snake of a frozen river to reach the drop zone north of Warsaw, where they unloaded Jankowski and five comrades. He jumped as a second lieutenant and landed a lieutenant. Agents parachuting into action automatically went up a rank when they came down to earth. At 7 in the morning, on the 4th of March 1942, some 13 hours after he boarded the Halifax, Jankowski got out of a train and read the station sign, Warschau Hauptbahnhof. Within a few weeks, he was assigned the task of organising the AK Intelligence Service's Legislation Department, codenamed Agaton, and began to look for recruits among his colleagues at the Faculty of Architecture. By providing a room for the forgery studio and allowing three of his staff to run it, Professor Zakwatowicz made the building even more critically important to the national cause than it had been already. With its library, archives, classrooms, and intelligence links, it was a bastion of integrated cultural and military resistance. Around 300 students took part in the clandestine academy. Their professors legalized the degrees they awarded by backdating them to before the war. As well as providing materials for the intelligence network, the personnel of the faculty themselves picked up information through their contacts with the German administrators. At the offices of the municipal board, Zakwatowicz saw a tabletop model of a Nazi vision for the city, Die neue deutsche Stadt Warschau. The concept had been developed at the instigation of Oskar Dengel, whom the occupiers appointed mayor of Warsaw in November 1939. This was a vaulting promotion for an official whose most senior municipal positions to that point had been those of treasurer and deputy mayor of Würzburg, a provincial Bavarian city with a population of 107,000. Dengel engaged the head of Würzburg's planning department, Hubert Gross, who brought a 20-strong team from the office with him. Gross had previously come up with a design for remodelling Würzburg, which he presented to Hitler in June 1939 at the Führer's Bavarian holiday residence near Berchtesgaden. Hitler took a close interest in the plans and gave the project his approval. Now Gross and his colleagues came up with a plan that would cut Warsaw down to Würzburg's size. They lifted illustrations from a short book by Oskar Sosnowski on the history of Warsaw's street layout, published by the Institute of Polish Architecture in 1930, to show what they proposed to destroy. The plan envisaged the erasure of almost the whole main part of the city, the left bank on the western side of the Vistula, apart from a few heritage showpieces. There would be ample room for the new population, which would be exclusively German and much smaller than the pre-war one. By 1939, the capital had grown into a metropolis containing more than 1 million people on the western side of the river, and nearly 250,000 on the eastern or right bank, 1.3 million in all. Under the Würzburg team's plan, the new German city would accommodate less than a tenth of that number on the western bank, and a huddled mass of Poles would live in a township on the eastern side, crossing the river to provide labour for the Germans. The only district to be retained was the old town. In the Nazi view, its Gothic origins attested to German roots. It would accordingly serve as a seal of authenticity. A similar approach was conceived later by the architect in charge of planning the new German town of Auschwitz, Hans Stossberg. He proposed to keep the historic old town assemblage defined by the market square, the town hall, and the castle as a symbol of the medieval German settler spirit that had been awakened by the Nazi drive to the east. The movement of settlers on which he based the idea had been instigated by the local Polish lords who lived in the castle. It had come to an end 600 years previously, but would serve as a foundation myth for the new town that was to be ordered around avenues, parade grounds, and party buildings, like the ones the planners modelled for Würzburg and Warsaw. The municipal authorities' ambitions provoked boundary disputes within the SS, which was in charge of the adjacent concentration camp. In Warsaw, there was no question of keeping the historic assemblage together, because the royal castle could not be presented as anything other than Polish. Even true Völkisch believers would struggle to take in the notion that the old town was German in essence, if the royal castle was still standing next to it. The medieval settlement had grown up in a symbiotic association with the castle, which occupied a position of supreme symbolic authority. The royal castle faced the city's founding quarter. It sat high on the scarp overlooking the river, and it formed the head of the royal route, a spinal column of prestige along which a succession of palaces was aligned as far as the monarch's summer residence, 13 kilometres to the south. But it did not appear on the plan for the new German city. Although the Nazis were inclined to keep the palaces, they were intent on demolishing the royal castle and thereby decapitating the historic complex. The act would assert that they had extirpated Polish nationhood. Oskar Dengel's tenure in the Warsaw Post only lasted until March 1940, and the plan he sponsored was set aside after he was transferred to France. A relic of the project's supporting material survived in the form of a model of the old town, which was shown to the territorial governor, Hans Frank, and the Warsaw governor, Ludwig Fischer, during the occupiers' Days of German Culture Festival in 1942. The model was not exhibited within the old town itself. By that stage, it was safer for Germans to contemplate the historical representation than to inspect the real thing. The old town had a life of its own, recalled Stanisław Lorenz, the director of the National Museum. There weren't many Germans to be seen, and there were fewer and fewer of them as time went on, when they began to die in the old town alleys. Lorenz had gone to live in a tenement used as an annex to the Boryczka house, which, together with its neighbours, had been renamed the Museum Alt Warschau after the occupation authorities ejected his family from their apartment in the city centre. The museum's German overseer had planned to use it for an exhibition portraying German influences on Warsaw's architecture, but its Polish curator had other ideas. Before the First World War, the Boryczka house had been a hub for genteel cultural resistance to Russian rule. Now its ancillary buildings became a hub for conspiratorial armed resistance to the German occupiers, with a cache of weapons in a cellar. These remained undiscovered despite cavalier attitudes towards security that alarmed Lorenz. He reproved the curator for openly making offensive remarks about the Germans, but to little effect. That kind of behaviour was the old town style at the time. Groups of musicians would often gather in tenement courtyards to play patriotic and anti-German songs. As the occupation went on, the inhabitants of the old town expressed their opposition increasingly openly. After a drinking session, two members of Lawrence's staff took their songs out of the annex and onto the market square, shouting, "We've got something for the Germans." It was not an empty threat. One of them took part in the attacks that reduced the number of occupiers at large in the district. He kept the guns he took from the Germans in his room until a raid on the adjacent building sent him fleeing barefoot onto the rooftops. Lorenz ordered him to get rid of the weapons immediately for fear that a raid would reveal the arms in the cellar. They were eventually handed over to the district's resistance command at the outset of the Warsaw Uprising on the 1st of August 1944.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.